Welcome everyone to our next edition of Dun & Bradstreet CFO Club. We are very privileged to have with us Ms. Aparna Iyer, Corporate Treasurer and Head of Investor Relationship, Wipro. Hi Aparna, welcome to Dun & Bradstreet CFO Club. It's really a pleasure to have you.
Hi Naina, and hi to everyone.
Aparna, we will start, you know, very interesting journey that you have. You know, you started your career with Wipro and since the last 17 years, and you have been in different functions. Why don't you tell us a little bit about, you know, your journey in Wipro?
Yeah, you know, I'm a chartered accountant. I finished my chartered accountancy in 2002. I incidentally topped India. And soon after that, you know, Wipro, you know, made an offer through the campus, and I entered the Wipro campus in April 2003. And like they say, rest is history. I've been with Wipro now for the last 17 years. It's been a wonderful journey. You know, I started out in internal audit. We were a batch of six people. In those days, six was a large batch to hire, but now Wipro has grown tremendously since then. I've done various roles, including, you know, finance planning and analysis, and I moved into business finance, was supporting pricing and large deals pricing, and then eventually I was heading the finance function for infrastructure services, cloud infrastructure services, which is one of the lines of business. And then I moved back to head FP&A, reporting into the CFO. And after that, in the last 2.5 years, I moved into being the corporate treasurer and also overseeing investor relations. So it's been a wonderful journey. Yeah.
You've been in Wipro throughout your career. So if I may ask you that, you know, what is the role that an organization can play in the development of a particularly a finance function? So, you know, if you've seen that, you know, what are the kind of things that, you know, you think that has really helped to build up your career the way it is today?
So, you know, Wipro is a wonderful organization to work for, especially for a you know, finance professional. You know, the kind of standards that we have in terms of governance and compliance is really exemplary. And it's for a young finance professional, you know, who's coming in and forming their habits and, you know, building the initial foundation. It really helps to work with an organization like Wipro, where, you know, the code of working, the work ethics, and, you know, the integrity, you know, that's built into every aspect of what we do, is a great foundational pillar on which then you can build. The second aspect, of course, you know, we have an independent board. We've got, you know, we are pioneers in adopting every, you know, law of the land, you know, so to speak. And, you know, it really triggers that, you know, we've got to meet the laws, you know, in more in spirit than just in letter, right? And that's a wonderful attribute to carry for any finance professional. And then, of course, we've got some very wonderful practices. We run something called as the cohort program. And as a part of that, you are rotated out into multiple functions. So, for example, I joined in an audit, and after 2 years, I was mandatorily rotated out to another function. So I rotated into finance planning and analysis. Similarly, every young professional who comes within a span of, let's say, 5 years, we ensure they see you know, two distinct functions. They could be business finance and controllership, or treasury, IR, you know, corporate taxation, secretarial. So there are varied functions to choose from, and there is rotation that's meticulously planned for you. And after that, every 3 years, you're rotated out into a different field. So I think rotation into various aspects is another way. It's very well thought through, and your career is being very meticulously planned, you know, given the strengths that you have. So I would say that the whole, you know, talent planning, that's a big differentiator, you know, for that, you know, something that the organization adds to you. And of course, in Wipro, we have a wonderful program, you know, within the finance function. And last but not the least, I would say it's how the function is viewed, right? If you look at finance in Wipro, it's not just doing a job of being a good controller or someone who will account things well. We are truly valued as a business partner. We're seen as people who will make business happen. In fact, if you were to take any poll or survey amongst the business leaders in Wipro, they would always say that the person who understands the business next best is their finance partner, right? So that's something that we've always taken huge pride in. As a function, we understand business. We are seen to be as enabling business rather than just controlling business. And, we are truly co-pilots in that sense of steering the ship of business. So that's something that I think stands out. And that's why it's truly incredible to work in a place like Wipro, or a large function.
And you are truly the brand ambassador. The way, the passion you're speaking about the company, it completely comes up. And, and I completely agree with you that, we have been speaking to many CFOs and everybody says how the function has changed, from somebody who was a controller to somebody who was an enabler.
Absolutely.
And everybody sees it as a next to the CEO kind of a role to run the business.
Absolutely.
So, in the last, IT industry, it's booming and, though in pandemic, a lot of business has probably seen a little bit of setback, but that's not in, the ITES space at all. So, in the last 17 years, I'll keep that in one side and 2020 in one side. What has been the learning or how you navigated that year? If there's anything special that you did?
Yeah. So, we are present across 53 countries, and I'm sure any large Indian IT services company will have, a reasonably good global footprint like Wipro's. And one thing that really struck us was that sometime during mid-January, we became cognizant of the fact that there was a brewing situation in China. And given that we had operations in China, we knew that the gravity of the situation and, what it could be if it were to spread. So, sometime during the latter half of February, we did invoke the business continuity plans in China, and we started to move our people who were working in offices within China to work from home, and we knew exactly what had to be done. And then, of course, when it was declared a global pandemic, we were completely ready for the situation. So what we did was we had to, as an industry, we stepped up, and I think India came out really shining in that sense, that nearly all of us were able to so beautifully move into a global delivery model, so to speak. Everybody across countries, we were able to move our workforce to work from home. It was a big exercise. And we had to enable infrastructure, especially for our ITES business, what we call as the business process services, where we are used to working in more than one shift, right? There the infrastructure was available only within offices. So we really had to put in, a lot of effort in enabling that every employee's infrastructure was set up at home. We had to enhance our cybersecurity controls because we're going to have all these employees logging in from various networks across India and across the world. So yeah, there was a lot of thought that was put in. There was a lot of, it was a very, very mechanical exercise that we had to keep repeating till we ensured everything, and it was iterative. And by I think April end, nearly 97%, 95% of our workforce was actually working from homes. And even today, I would say only about less than 2 or 3% of our people actually come to office, right? So everybody has continued to work from home. We delivered on all important milestones for our customers. There were, several time critical processes that we handled for our customers, like salary processing or an important integration that had to do, or book close processes. We've been able to successfully manage all that for our customers. Of course, in collaboration with our customers. I think our customers also came around and gave us the necessary approvals to work. So it has been it's a very shining moment for just the Indian IT services sector, the way we've stepped up and the way we've transitioned. And after the initial shock, Naina, I would say that, you know, the sector has recovered so well and it was able to meet the growing business demand. So one was the supply side constraints, you know, so we had to ensure people could continue to deliver and that was safely, you know, maintaining all protocols that we've signed with our customers. The second was, and how do we enable our customers to get back to work like the way we have done? So that journey was even more fascinating. So to ensure our customers could get to work from home, how they use collaborative tools, how we are now helping our customers become more resilient. How are we driving resilience into their infrastructure, helping them adopt newer technologies like cloud? I think that's been a fascinating journey. And that's why the demand for IT services has only increased, you know, because of the way we responded to the crisis. Our customers have come back with a lot more confidence, you know. Naina, you would know that IT services almost always works in an on-site offshore model, right? Correct. So let's say 20-30% of our workforce was always present in our customers' offices on-site, and the rest would work from, you know, nearshore locations across the world. But, you know, in this pandemic, because people haven't been able to travel out, we've actually shown our customer that nearly all the work can be done from offshore, including large transformations, transitions. So yes, you know, I think our customers will take heart. They've grown in confidence and so have we. Right, I'm sure.
It's a newer way of working all across, right? People, I mean, so, you know, digital has, I hear many people say that, you know, digital adoption, which couldn't happen in like 5 years, happened in like 5 days.
Correct.
So that kind of thing.
It was, you know, unprecedented, yes.
Yes, it's absolutely unprecedented in that context. You know, as a corporate treasurer, because it was a global pandemic. So, right. You know, what are the kind of challenges you faced as a corporate treasurer and how do you navigate those challenges?
Yeah. So, you know, if you look at it, you know, luckily for Wipro, you know, we are a very, very, our balance sheet, if you look at it, like any other IT services company, has very little debt on it. And, you know, we are very, very cash rich. And therefore, we had to worry a lot less about raising money or wondering. But obviously, we were on, you know, we were extremely vigilant about two or three aspects. We needed to make sure that the working capital needs across all our subsidiaries was very well, you know, they were all very well funded, because, you know, there were situations where, you know, certain central banks in certain countries were, you know, overnight changing the rules of the game. And so we wanted to make sure every subsidiary was well funded. And we ensured that, you know, we tapped into all our overdraft lines and you know, ensured we beefed up our working capital lines. And of course, you know, we did see that, you know, the credit situation that was evolving, both, you know, in our customer side. So we had to make sure that we were very clear of the risks that we were running on those side. And, you know, we had to ensure, and we were on a vigil, you know, and that's an important aspect of what we do as a part of corporate treasury in Wipro. The entire credit evaluation framework resides within this function. So we ensured that we did more research and we were more proactive. We analyzed our customers' strengths and, you know, ensured that, you know, if there were worsening ratios, then, you know, how do we adopt a more conservative stance in terms of our accounting? And we also ensured, we worked with our customers to ensure that we were getting paid on time. And we, you know, the whole process, right, because our customers were also in need, and therefore to, you know, help our customers. So, you know, it's a very important decision to see, you know, how much you could help, who are the good customers whom you could bet on, and, you know, take that risk. Because at the end of the day, if you see, you know, Wipro would be happy to take on performance risk on what we do well. We deliver global delivery services, and that's a risk we are happy to take, but credit risk, right? Because that's not what we are in the business for. So as a job, as a treasurer, I had to ensure that we mitigated that risk as much as we could, right? So one of the things that we did was to proactively, analyze the situation of balance sheets and, you know, financials of our customers, you know, rate them, ensure that, you know, those who are considered risky, right, we take a very conservative position. Then we look at how we could de-risk that, you know, either by doing an AR sale and looking at, you know, various innovative ways of, you know, taking that risk out of the balance sheet. So these were some of the steps that we did take, as a part of the pandemic. And, we came out really well. If you look at just our whole free cash flows as a percentage of net income, it's been, significantly higher compared to what we did last year. So our whole receivables management has been done so well, and it's because of the rigor, it's because of the attention that we've given. We've made sure that, you know, we were not caught in any wrong credit. And, those were some of the aspects that we faced.
A lot of hard work and a lot of calculative risk. You can.
Absolutely. That was from a treasury standpoint, but even generally, outside of that, I mean, like Wipro was the first company in the Nifty 50 to go out and declare its results in April 2020, you know, right, because the whole book close process was being done virtually. And since we were the first to go ahead and announce our results, you know, a lot of them called us to understand how we did, how we managed, what we did, and how we met the timeline. You know, Naina, we'd actually given out these dates well in advance. We'd signed up with a board and we didn't want to change it. So we said, let's just give it a try. And, you know, it was incredible journey what we did through the first 2 weeks of April to be able to put out those results without any delay and to go first through a whole virtual book close. That was a very exciting.
So you actually set the precedent for every other company to follow, right?
That's
that gives so much of value to your shareholders and your stakeholders, and
absolutely,
that reflects the way the numbers moved, right?
And then it reflects the strength of the function. It shows the strength of the processes, the internal processes that we have. So in some sense, yes, you know, that was a big challenge, right? And I'm sure a lot of corporates are going through it. How do you adopt technology to ensure everything that we were doing physically, right now everything has to move, you know, including various compliances, right? And we also have, because we're listed on both NSE BSE here, and we're listed in NYSE in the US, a lot of these compliance rigors are phenomenal, right? I mean, how do you therefore work and ensure, none of your confidential information, financials that you're now handling in multiple homes of employees across is leaked. So, you know, there's so much that, one has to, and thankfully we have various technologies that we use, right?
Interesting to know a little bit about, the corporate governance part. As you were talking, that, multiple people, multiple country, multiple regulators, you can't go wrong. How did you manage, that entire framework so that, as you said, no messages are leaked. Plus, you met all the, all the regulators, the compliance, the requirements.
So, obviously we have our whole, IRMC, which is our internal risk management control frameworks that we have. And we have a team which is looking at risk monitoring continuously. We also have, our chief CISO, right? Chief Information Securities Officer, who's also responsible to ensure that, all our technologies are kept, they are on a vigil, they're constantly testing and monitoring, the activity that's happening on the network. A lot of us have, of course, switched to using, our ERP using the VPN, which is a virtual private network, and therefore we are able to access information from where we are. And, there is continuous communication from the top leadership, right, as to what are the do's and don'ts and how do you therefore ensure that, you're your information is confidential. Thanks to, you know, whole lot of things, like now we are using Teams very extensively so as to be able to therefore, you know, interact. And, you know, if we are taking, you know, private conversations, we are encouraged to use headphones so that even your family members who are not supposed to know don't come to know of it. How do you create, therefore, buffered zones even within, you know, from where you're working, right? So there are a lot of virtual work environments. You've got SharePoint folders through which we exchange information rather than just use emails. You know, Teams is a great example of how, you know, we collaborate. And there is continuous information of do's and don'ts, right? And, you know, the CFO himself takes out time and ensures that he, you know, communicates to the larger team saying, you know, what's good for the organization, what are the things that you can do, what you can't do, how do you keep your information, and then of course there are various security protocols that we have that, you know, help us meet the process. So it's a combination of both process, intent at the top, and technology, which helps us, you know, keep this whole cycle of compliance, Naina. So That's
very, very good to know, you know, like, I mean, I'm sure, you know, the stakeholders, shareholders will be very happy to know, you know, the kind of compliance and the rigor that you all are following.
Right.
I would also like to come here as a part of the communication. You said that your CFO, anyway, everybody communicates to, you know, from top to bottom. So, you know, in the finance function, what is the role communication can play that you think that, you know, that has really helped to make decisions more robust plus quick?
You know, I think, like they say, right, that, you know, today, you know, it's a thing of the past to say that data was something that finance provided. Today, everybody expects data to be democratized, right? So everybody wants to have data on their fingertips. It's no longer a question of why do you need this information. It is, you know, why not, right? So everybody should be able to have access to all kinds of information. So gone are those days when you said data should be shared in silos and only, you know. So in some sense that, you know, today a lot more project managers, business leaders want to have information on their fingertips. And it's not just about how the data, you know, just the data, it's not just about, and it's also about how well it is presented, right? Today you're having several tools that you have at your disposal, like, you know, you can have Power BI, you can use ever so many ways of representing that data so powerfully, right? So in some sense, yes, you know, one of the things that finance can do is to democratize data, to make sure it's available to everybody on a real-time basis. And, you know, it is there for people to take decision-making, you know, because it's just that's what actually, you know, we when we say that we want the company to be agile, it means that the people who are on the edge of the organization, right, those who are right at the cusp between your organization and the customer's organization are fully empowered. Now, when you say words like empowered, what does it mean? You empower the person with information to take right decisions, right? And if your information is good, then very often you're setting that person up for right decision making. I think that's what the whole journey is about for Wipro Finance, to ensure that information is available to those at the edge and in a manner that they are able to take right decisions. That's one of the important parts of communication. The other thing is obviously, you know, one of the critical goals of any finance professional should be to drive objectivity, right, of decision making. Very often, sometimes, you know, people get very emotional about certain business decisions and certain. So, you know, when you bring data into it, you bring objectivity, and therefore you're able to just take emotions out, and you're able to resolve many conflicts by just, you know, something that's as black and white. And you know, so it's about all. So therefore, in that sense, I would say that communication today is all about data, is all about making sure everybody has that data, to be able to take faster decisions. And how you present the data today matters a lot more than just, you know, realms and realms of Excel sheet, for which people don't have the time and patience today. People want bite-sized data.
Absolutely. Right. I will go a little back, Aparna, from the time you become a CA to now. So, you know, when you became a CA, you have certain visions, certain ambitions in your life.
Right.
Where you have reached now and what are the changes you have seen? And, you know, I mean, there's some things you may have thought that this will be like this and something has changed completely. So I just want to understand from, you know, like the last two decades, what are the kind of, you know, top three changes that you've seen in the function?
I think just the amount of effort that people are willing to put on automation. You know, back in the days when I joined the company, while we were automating, while we were adopting technology, I think the pace, and like I said, you know, how agile the technology has become. You know, in those days, you know, you would have the entire ERP on-prem. Today now everything is on cloud, right? And everything is so beautifully designed that it can be easily customized for, you know, it can be very easily customized for any organization to tailor any needs, right? So in that sense, I feel the technology has really changed, and the intent to automate, right? Now, every finance professional who joins today is also keen on automating. They're all wanting to use newer technologies. Almost everybody wants to read up and at least wants to know, you know, what's Python about, you know, how can I quickly learn to code? Can I just do some quick code and automate? I think that in willingness, the mindset and the whole, how conducive the atmosphere has become to adopting technology is a clear shift, right? That's one thing that I would say is one of the top changes and the more positive changes that one has, and therefore that has enabled a lot more work-life balance, if I may say, right? Again, you know, I think that's another thing that this generation, this of millennials, are bringing in, saying that they want to have a life beyond just work, right? How do you therefore shape your perspective? So I think when we came in, we took pride in the fact that, you know what, we're willing to give everything we have to a company, right? It could be any workplace, and you were willing to go on weekends beyond work hours, and you were in a race to differentiate, compete, and, you know, get to the top. But in some sense, today, I think the way the millennials look at it is, I want that, but I also want to have my life. So the fact that they're able to draw that line, that's a very refreshing change. That's the second positive that I would say. Because today there are more avenues for people to continuously learn, even outside of work. You know, people sign up on courses on Coursera or Udemy or, you know, ever so many things. So that's another refreshing change that I would think in terms of the type of people who join us and their mindsets and what they bring. So those are two refreshing changes that I would say that stand out for me, you know, in the sense of just people and how they work, Naina. So it's very good.
Excellent. I will, you know, because we are very close to the most important event in Indian, you know, financial history, like the budget is around the corner. So I want to understand, you know, any expectations from the IT industries that you guys have, that you're looking at in the budget, that you want to say, or
right. So you know, I'm going to answer this in three levels. So obviously, you know, just the way the economy is today, right? Just let's take the macro picture first. You know, obviously, if you look at it, last year has been a very tough year for India. And we went through some of the most strict lockdowns, which put a lot of hardship. And if you look at the way, you know, one of the reasons, one of the biggest impact of this pandemic on, you know, on the Indian society would be how there's going to be a bigger rise in inequality, right? Because the whole recovery is K-shaped, with rich becoming richer and the poor becoming poorer. So, you know, I think the last 3 months, like the RBI said, from a bitter winter to a glorious summer, we are seeing signs of recovery. And I think these are still early stages. So the government will keep that in mind. And this would, I'm hoping, be a budget more for revival and, you know, something that can keep the pace of recovery intact. They have very little room to spend more because you know that our fiscal deficit was quite high. It's likely to be very high for FY21, about 7% or so. And so that'll be interesting to see how, you know, do they cut back on spending or they don't. My hope is that they don't cut back and they continue to spend, especially in areas of infrastructure. It'll be very interesting to see what they do on disinvestment. That's another big area through which the government can generate revenues for it to spend. I think it's important for the government to spend. So I'm hoping they will continue to spend on infrastructure. I'm hoping they'll continue to spend on schemes like MNREGA. Like I said, you know, there is a lot of unemployment that is there in the urban and the rural areas, and MNREGA can really help. So those are two or three things, you know, saying that, you know, what's the will of the government in disinvestment? If they're able to sell off some of their good assets and raise money, it'll give them leeway to spend. So those are two or three areas that I think they will do. And personally, of course, you know, I'm sure a lot of salaried people will want a higher standard deduction, more rebates on ETC, maybe higher, you know, reductions in ETD, you know, under medical insurance. These are all good things to do because you want people to spend on medical insurance. You want people to invest in, you know, the papers that the government comes out. So if there are any incentives that work, you know, something that can be a relief for the middle class. So that's something. Of course, as an IT sector, we've put our proposals to the finance ministry. We've shared our ideas. You know, obviously, we would like them to extend more support to the SEZ. You know, the special economic zones that we create for export-oriented industries, and the support that they extend to that. You know, we'd always be happy. They have reduced the MAT, and you know, we hope that they continue to, you know, keep lowering the corporate tax rate structure. Maybe a higher reduction, more incentives for research and development (R&D), so that, you know, we are able to innovate more. These are some ideas, and we've shared, and I'm sure the government has enough on their hands, right? And it's a tough task, but like they say, never waste a good crisis, right? So I'm sure they're looking at reforms, and I'm sure they're going to be looking at how to make the best of this, you know, because this gives us such a terrific opportunity for India, you know, given our vaccine diplomacy and how we've come out so strong in the whole, you know, process vis-a-vis, you know, maybe China, right? This is a great moment, and you know, I'm sure everybody is looking at how to diversify their supply chain. If we can prove ourselves to be a credible alternative to the world, I think this can be a big opportunity. And I think the government will, I'm looking forward to the fact, you know, how do we ease of doing business going up, single window clearances for maybe FDIs, you know, a whole lot of things that they can do. We have done, and hopefully they'll keep taking more steps towards reforms. These are general expectations.
Yes, all our eyes on 1st of February.
That's right. Yeah, big day.
Yeah, very, very big day. Thank you so much, Aparna. It's been really a pleasure talking to you. And, you know, really, really, I'm sure our viewers will also enjoy this discussion. Thank you once again.
Thanks, Naina. Great catching up. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.